गुड इवनिंग. सो वी आर कंटिन्यूइंग विद द श्रीमद् भगवद गीता. दिस इज चैप्टर 12. वी हैड स्टॉप्ड एट वर्स 12. सो नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू बिगिन वर्स 13 ऑनवर्ड्स. दिस इज अ चैप्टर, इट्स अ वेरी शॉर्ट चैप्टर ऑफ 20 वर्सेस इन विच श्री कृष्णा हिमसेल्फ इज डिस्क्राइबिंग द डिवोशनल पाथ. इन विच इन द प्रीवियस वर्स वी हैड सीन दैट there are four steps in which he has said that you are able to achieve. Now what are those four steps? We'll just go over them. He says that practice better than practice. So first is practicing any kind of meditation, whatever that you practice, any kind of path that you are practicing. Let us say even the yogic path, you know, you are doing hatha yoga, you may be doing meditation, you are doing whatever that is required at that point in time. You are doing, say, pranayama also. So if you, that is a practice that you are doing, you have to continue doing it. Higher than the practice, that means practice will be the lowest rung, fourth rung. Higher than the practice, he says, is knowledge. So knowledge is what leads us to Krishna. So number three point is knowledge. So if you have knowledge but you don't have too much of a practice, that is that's okay, doesn't matter. With knowledge you can reach Krishna. Then he says, let us come to rung two. Higher than knowledge is meditation. Meditating is single pointedly keeping Sri Krishna in your mind and intellect and in your heart. This is rung two. And even superior to meditation is called the renunciation of the fruit of action. Whatever action that you do, you should never bother about what is going to come out of it. That means you are doing the action for the sake of doing the action. Only for Krishna. I had explained to you that he has put you in this world. The tasks, the jobs, whatever opportunities that are coming easily to you, what comes in your plate just like that, could lead you to what is called as a swadharma. So if you were to do that swadharma diligently, following the path on a very regular basis, continuously doing it as if it's an offering to Krishna. Because at the end of the day, that task has come to you only through his grace. And you are there for doing the task only through his grace. So both of these things are coming together only by the grace of Krishna. And because the grace of Krishna is there, what are we supposed to do? Not bother about what the fruits are going to be. So suppose if you are doing a particular activity, let us say you are a farmer or you are even a potter. Now you are doing your pottery business or making pots or whatever, completely lost in Krishna. There is a very beautiful story of Gora Kumhar. Now Gora Kumar was totally devoted to Krishna. Krishna's form in Pandharpur is there, which is called Vitthala. Okay? Now he was totally devoted to this Krishna's form. And he was so engrossed while making those pots that one day his child comes crawling inside when he is crushing the mud. You see, you are supposed to jump on top of the mud and crush it, mix it with the water, the clay. So he's mixing the clay. He doesn't realize that his child has gone inside that mud. And the child dies. He is completely lost in the devotion to the Lord. His wife comes at that time and asks him, "What have you done? You have killed your own son, a small baby." Gora Kumar looks at her and says, "It's the will of Krishna." At that time, Vitthala comes in front of him and gives the child back to him. That is the story of Gora Kumbhar. So here the truth is this, that you have to do your duty, swadharma, without focusing on the result. This is also, there is also a story in the Guru Charitra, where there is a particular devotee of Narasimha Saraswati. And one day Narasimha Saraswati says, I will come to your house for lunch. He's invited over there. Now this particular person doesn't have any food at home. He has got children, his wife is there, but they have one small, you know, veil, we call it a creeper outside. And it had those small beans. So the wife removes those beans and makes a little sabji, and she makes a little, you know, kind of a gravy kind of a thing for Narasimha Saraswati. Now he eats that thing. And while going out of the house, he tugs that creeper and pulls it out from the ground. The wife gets very upset, the children get upset, and they say to this man, what kind of a guru do you have? He has removed those things. That is the food that we eat and that is the food that we are giving him. What kind of a bad guru you have? He's destroyed that plant. He says, this particular devotee says, don't say anything to my guru, because he is God Almighty. He must have done it for some purpose and I don't know the purpose. He says, let me plant it back. And he takes one stick and starts digging over there. And when he digs, there's a clunk. And then when he opens that, then below that, there is a pot of gold which they find. Then he tells his wife, look, my Gurudev has given me this. Whatever you offer to Krishna, you should never bother about thinking, what am I going to get back? You see, with every other god you can do that except Krishna. The reason is because when you go to any of these temples, like in Mumbai there are temples which I was talking about yesterday also. Siddhi Vinayak temple, Mahalakshmi temple, you know all those beautiful temples that are there. You may go to Amba Bhavani temple, you can go to whichever temple you want in India. You see the huge queue in Tirupati. People are there with a lot of offering, but with a very big pot. They are begging for something. You don't beg anything from Krishna. Krishna's rule is very simple. Don't bother about the fruits of action. Whatever action that you do, you may offer me a leaf also, doesn't matter. That is not in your hands. So this is what we had done in the morning. So now let us continue verse 13 and 14. So I hope you got those four steps. We are doing Srimad Bhagavad Gita chapter 12 verse 13 and 14. He who is free from malice towards all beings, friendly and compassionate, free from the feeling of I and mine, balanced in joy and sorrow, forgiving by nature, ever contented and mentally united with me, nay, who has subdued his mind, senses and body, has a firm resolve and has surrendered his mind and reason to me, that devotee of mine is dear to me. So here he is saying something very, very beautiful. He who is free from malice towards all being. There should be no malice towards anybody in this world. Let anybody do whatever they feel like. Another person may act mean. He will be very ruthless with you. He can do whatever he feels like. He may call you names. Whatever the other person does, you are not supposed to do that. You as a devotee should never have malice towards not a single person in this world. Those people could be the greatest villains of all. But still, there should be no malice towards them. No. You cannot have any ill feelings. Even the thought should not come in your mind, I want to show this person. Nobody has been given the right to say anything bad to, you know, if he wants to be the devotee of Krishna. A true devotee of Krishna doesn't utter even one bad word or wrong thing to anybody. This is the ultimate truth. Only those people who bear malice towards none, they are friendly and compassionate with everybody. They have to be friendly and compassionate to everybody, which means there are people in this world who are literally bent backwards. They are there at their wits' end. Especially when people come to me, they are in such debilitating conditions. Their conditions are so bad. They are not able to see through their life. When such kind of people come to me, do you think I will even say anything to them? On the contrary, I have to be very, very friendly. I have to be very compassionate with them. The compassion has to overflow. Being nice and being your good self is the ultimate way of reaching Krishna. Please remember this. There is no other way. This is the only path which Krishna preaches. It's called the path of love and devotion. Have you not noticed in the beginning of this chapter, Krishna has gone and cancelled out all other paths? On his own he has said, it is very difficult to follow the path of knowledge. It is very difficult to follow the path of any other yoga. It is difficult to follow even karma yoga, raj yoga. You can do whatever yoga that you want to. You can do kriya yoga also. You will not be able to reach Krishna. Krishna himself has mentioned it, that it is next to impossible to reach me if you are following any other path in this world. It is very easy to go to any other god that you want to with that path. See, if you are following the kriya yoga, or if you are following the path of tantra, a mantra, whatever that you have been taught, wherever that you have been taught, you can only reach somewhere in the middle. Those are demigods you are going to reach. Demigods is not the ultimate god at all. Demigod means half gods. Demi, half. They are deities. They are deities who handle certain departments. They are not the ultimate destination for anybody. That is why even Jesus Christ said, my Father in heaven. He never said anything different. Krishna also says the same thing. He says, I am the ultimate destination. All the other demigods, you will go to their heavens. And then the path is back to earth to be reborn again. But those who come to me, there is no rebirth. And the only path which is the most easiest and the simplest is called the path of devotion. And this is what he says. Being nice to anybody, being kind and compassionate. What is the big deal in that? Why do you have to have malice towards anybody? Don't you see Krishna's path is so easy and simple? He says you don't have to have any ill feelings or anything wrong about any other person. Everybody has to be treated nicely, genuinely, properly, friendly, and in a compassionate manner. And then you should have free from the feeling of I and mine. You should never say, I have been good to this person. Never ever say these words. The moment you say these words, I was always nice to this person. I've given him enough money. I have done so much for him. Or you will say, I have done so much for her. Whatever that you say, the moment you take this onus on yourself, you cannot be with Krishna at all. Because Krishna has said one thing very clearly. I have put you in that position. I have given you that authority. Doesn't mean that you flout it and say that you have done something. That is why the feeling of I, me, or myself should never come into the picture. Never ever say that I did it. You may do good to this world. You may be kind. You may be compassionate. You may donate to charity. You may give to your parents. You may give to your relatives, your friends. You can feed 1,000 people. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. But the thought coming to you that I did this or I offered so much to Krishna is the end of it all. You cannot reach Krishna. So don't ever have this feeling of I and mine. Balance in joy and sorrow. This is the difficult part. Yes. How can you be balanced in joy and sorrow? When you are joyful, you are beyond and, you know, literally smiling and happy about the whole issue. But when sorrow comes to you, how do you feel? You feel small, insignificant, as if you are destroyed completely. You don't know where to turn to. Isn't that what happens when sorrow strikes you? When you lose your most prized possession, maybe the prized possession could be your own children, could be your spouse, could be your father, mother. Somebody dies, somebody goes away. What happens to you? Naturally, you will be filled with sorrow. And Krishna says, the joy and the sorrow should not be even seen on your face. It should not even appear. You should be balanced in the joy and sorrow. Equanimity of mind. Why should it bother you? That is a person, that's a human being. No way related to you. Your parents cannot claim you because this body of yours is not your parents' property. Your spouse cannot claim property that this is my person, this is my husband or this is my wife. They cannot claim that. Your children cannot claim that this is my father or this is my mother. They're claiming your body. See, remember that. And when you die in the end, the fire consumes you or the earth consumes you. The fire cannot say this is my body. Whose body is it then? You also cannot claim your body. You cannot claim this body because when you were born, you got this body. When you died, you have to give up the body. Isn't that true? So then why are you claiming it? And this is the reason why he says, if some sorrow comes your way, why are you upset with that sorrow? Or why are you so joyful that something great happened? It's a course of this world. Something has to happen, good or bad. Why are you bothered so much? Don't have attachment to anybody or anything. If you have attachment to your body, to your parents, to children, whoever in this world, you're going to be sorrowful if you lose them. See, that is the reason why he says equanimity of mind. Only when you have equanimity of mind can you reach me. Forgiving by nature. Come whatever may, anybody can do whatever they feel like. You should always forgive the person. Forgiveness is divine. Only the Lord God can forgive. You see, in this world, God forgives everybody. Forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. When Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross, these were his words. He never said, I will show you, I will tell my Father in heaven. He was not talking like this. He never said, I will tell my Father, I will see to it that you go to hell. He never said anything like that. On the contrary, he told his Father in heaven, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. Why? Because forgiveness is divine. You are supposed to forgive everybody and everything in this world. Anybody can hurt you. Anybody can do anything to you. But still, you got to forgive them. Ever contented and mentally united with me. Ever contented. Whatever you have, are you contented with it? You have 5 rupees, you are not contented, you want 10 rupees. When you have 100 rupees, you want 200 rupees. When you have 1000 rupees, you want 10,000 rupees. You see, a man is never contented. If he has one car, the government of India is giving you extra discount on new cars because now you have to junk 20-year-old cars. So take extra discount and buy a new car. No contentment. Why do you need a new car? For what reason? Why do you need new clothes when you have already lots of clothes in the cupboard? You have to be feeling ever contented. Please understand this. What is the jewel that you have? You see, you should be having the jewel of contentment with you, not any other jewel. Not even a piece of gold. Not even a gold chain. Nothing. Contentment should be that, yes, I have everything. Whatever the Lord God provides me, whatever Krishna provides me, I have to be contented with it. I don't want Krishna to give me more. It's not required. If he wants me to be a king of this land, he will make me a king. Why do I need to bother about it all the time? That is called depending on Krishna. He says, you have to be ever contented with me. And you have to be united with me. This is what I am telling you. You have to be one with Krishna because Krishna wants you to have only that. He may give you just one meal a day. And you should be contented with that one meal a day. Not bother about, you know, what's going to happen, what will I eat in the evening, what will I eat tomorrow. Why are you bothered? See, if you become a sannyasi, you see all the sannyasis in India, they are bothered, where are they going to have a meal in the evening or in the morning? You go to Haridwar, you go to Rishikesh, you go to Banaras, you go to Tirunamalai or any other place, you will find all those sadhu babas waiting with their katoris outside. And they are waiting for that van to come so that food can be distributed to them. This is how people are. They are never satisfied. If you are a sadhu, if you are a sannyasi, why are you bothered? Then only you will be one with me. This is how it is. There is a story which I can tell you about a very great saint. Now this one particular saint had gone to Vrindavan. And in Vrindavan he was going just roaming around. He had not eaten for many days. And he was just lying in one place. He never went to ask for food from anybody. And at that time when he was going into a drowsy state, a young, small, you know, two children came over there, a boy and a girl. And they were playing near him and they saw him lying over there. And they woke him up and they asked him, "What is wrong with you?" He said, "Nothing." "Oh, you have not eaten anything. Okay, just wait. I will go home and I will get it." These two children ran home. And they got him a nice fresh meal. And they gave him and he ate it. Later on, he went to find that village where the children said, "Oh, we are staying here only nearby." There was nothing nearby. There was not even a village. Radha and Krishna had come and fed him. This is how it is. And this is absolutely true for those who depend on Krishna themselves. You see, you don't have to bother about where your meal is going to come from. I'm not joking. This is how it is. It comes on its own. So, mentally united with me, nay, who has subdued his mind, senses and body. These are three things which you have to subdue. How many of you can say that you have subdued your mind? The answer will be zero. Because nobody can subdue the mind. It's very difficult. It's very tough to subdue the mind and body and senses. Your body is always moving outwards. Always looking for things. I want this, I want that, I want that, I want that. Human beings are like that. They love to go out. The eyes will wander here, hither, thither. That's how everybody is. But Krishna says, you have to control. Now see the words he is using. He is not saying that you have to destroy them. You have to control your mind, body and senses. You cut them. You control them. Keep them under control. There is no need for you to even feel the pain. Many a times you, oh, my stomach is hurting. People say these words if they have not eaten for some time. Why? What is the big deal? I have seen people literally fight at me, with me, when the food comes little late on the table. In many years I have seen this. People get very upset and angry if they don't get food in time. So it is my rule in this place, in wherever I stay, it's very important that the food has to be served at the right time. So it will always be served at 12:45 in the afternoon. Or it will be served, the breakfast will be served at 6:45 in the morning. 6:40 to be precise. This is, there is a system which has to be followed. And then you will be satisfied. So controlling your mind, senses, you see, this is very important. And now he says something very strange. See what he says. And surrender your mind and reason to me. With a firm resolve, take all these things and you surrender it to me. Give me that. Give me your power of attorney. Give me all your body, mind and senses. Just give it to me. And the reasoning that you do, no? Oh, this happens because of this, that happens because... That kind of reason which people have. I am doing this because of this. If there is, but there is. You know, people come with if, but, because, whatever. Other reason. Don't give all those reasons. There is no need. Give that reason to me also. And then, you will be mine. Krishna is saying very clearly, then you are a devotee of mine, dearest to me. So now you have understood, if you want to be the dearest devotee of Krishna, first start from the point where he says, never have malice towards anybody. Let people do whatever they feel like, whatever they may do, it doesn't matter. Got it? Alright, so we'll move to the next verse. We are doing chapter 12, verse 15 from the Bhagavad Gita. He who is not a source of annoyance to his fellow creatures, and who in his turn does not feel vexed with his fellow creatures, and who is free from delight and envy, perturbation and fear, is dear to me. Anytime when you are with me, I will always be pulling your leg. Let me tell you this much. I will make you get angry. That's the way how it is. You know, I really love stalking you in such a manner that you are going to get very upset and angry many a times. So it's Krishna's job. Krishna does, in my world, I call it Kalakandi. Kalakandi means he's the guy who does all kinds of activities. Deliberately he'll do it. So here he says, never cause annoyance to anybody else. But Krishna is allowed, okay, please understand this. Because he is going to cause annoyance to everybody. You see, he will go and break somebody's pot, he will rob somebody. He causes annoyance to everybody because he is the Almighty God. But you as a human being never cause annoyance to anybody. Just imagine, your garage is there, and outside your garage, somebody else comes and parks the car. You are not able to remove your car. And this fellow disappears after leaving the car over there. You know how much of annoying it is, how annoying it is, right? What would you like to do? You would like to scratch his car, you want to puncture his tire, you want to do all kinds of wrong things, isn't it true? You want to throw stones at it. You want to do all kinds of nonsensical activities. Just because that person parks the car in front of your door. Never. Never do this kind of things yourself and never get annoyed if somebody else does this to you. Krishna is saying this because people are used to doing this kind of things. You should never get annoyed, angry or upset with anybody. Especially there are people who are used to literally, you know, we say in Hindi we call it chabi lagana. There are really people out there, the moment you see them, you know, you feel, oh my God, this person is here, you know. That comes to your mind and you feel so frustrated looking at that person. So don't get annoyed or angry or upset with that person. Never get vexed with fellow creatures. Krishna says, if you want to be my devotee, first don't become an annoying person to anybody. Alright? So don't annoy anybody. Don't keep on annoying a person. Secondly, you should never get upset if somebody annoys you. No. Don't get angry. Don't get upset. Let the world do what they want to. You should not lose your cool. Never lose your cool. And you should be always a delight, you know, to everybody. But you yourself should be free from delight and envy. People should say, you know, oh, he's a good guy. But don't say to yourself, I am a good guy. Don't say these words. Otherwise, people love to say, I am a very good person. Don't even utter those words. Because you are not a good person if you say those words. Okay? This one thing you should say, you know, he who is free from delight and envy, never envy another person. Because envy is that which brings a person to ruin. Please remember that. We are envious because our neighbors have gathered a lot of ammunition. So if they have 250 nuclear weapons, we'll have 260. You can't do that. What are you going to do when Iran has already declared that they have more than India and Pakistan together? What are you going to do? And China is sitting on our head. Just because you want to, you know, show that one up, you will want to put more weapons in the... No, there's no need. It's the same thing. Envy is a wrong word. Don't bother. If your neighbor has a very good car, don't bother about it. Why are you bothered? Just admire it from far. That's it. So, then he says, perturbation and fear. You see, people are so perturbed by what happens around them. And they are very fearful. I was talking to somebody in the morning today. The person has lost everything in life, literally everything, brought to ruins. It's a young person. I just told him, I said, don't worry. It is the fear which will not allow you to take any steps in life. Don't worry, just put your step forward and do what it is necessary to be done. Become fearless. When you are on the side of Krishna, fear should never strike you. No. Become fearless. Because your father in heaven, Krishna himself, is literally fearless. He doesn't have fear of anybody. So why should you have? So remember this. Now we go to the next verse. We are doing verse 16. We are doing Srimad Bhagavad Gita chapter 12 verse 16. He who expects nothing, who is both internally and externally pure, is wise and impartial and has risen over all distractions, and he who renounces the sense of doership in all undertaking, such a devotee of mine is dear to me. You should never expect anything from anybody. You see, expectation is the root cause of failures in every field. Think about it, in the marriage, in friendship. Why do friendship break down? Why do marriages crumble? Because one person has expectation from the other person has expectation from the first. And these expectations are the root cause of misery to everybody. You fall down because of these expectations. You have expectations from everybody in this world. You expect to come first in class. You expect that your papers have been written nicely. You expect that you should get admission in a super college. You are expecting for so many things in life. Why? For what reason? I was just now showing someone. A young person who started at the age of 4 and 5 singing songs. This young girl sang so brilliantly, so beautifully for many, many years. She used to do a little bit of performances by the time she was 16 and 18 years old. Now she is a world-class singer. Today, people say, wow, she sings so well. But that recognition has come after many, many years of practice, sadhana. It doesn't come overnight. No, nothing comes overnight. So in this case, don't expect that you are going to be a super-duper success in the first day itself. When people enter the stock market, they think that they are going to become billionaires and billionaires. Doesn't happen like that, sir. It has taken Warren Buffett years and years and years of hard work. So don't bother about that. Put in your efforts, but don't have expectations of anything. Expect nothing. Internally and externally pure, you should have purity of heart and purity of body. See, your heart has to be clean and pure. No hanky-panky. No evil thoughts. Your mind has to be clean, crystal clear. Likewise, your external body. You see, if you are impure, because you are doing certain wrong things, maybe you are smoking, drinking, or doing whatever that is needed, maybe you are robbing things, that is impurity. Your internal and external should be pure. To be the devotee of Krishna, this is what is needed. And has risen over all distractions. You are wise and impartial and risen over distractions. You are a wise person. You have wisdom because you have knowledge and you know how to use the knowledge properly. And you are impartial. You can never have partiality. Oh, this one is dear to me. That is why I will give this person so much property. That one is not dear to me. He is not even bothered to call me. I will not give. Not like that. You have to be impartial. There should be no qualifying factor for giving somebody less and somebody more. No. Impartiality. And you have to rise over all distractions, which means your mind is constantly distracted. I haven't found a single person in my life till today who will listen to the whole thing single-pointedly. If I say certain things, here I am telling you this and I keep on saying certain things, the person is already distracted in the first line itself and the person is offering me answers. Well, there is no need to offer answers. Listening is important. So there should be no distraction. Your mind should never be distracted. You have to single-pointedly do your job. When people, now you're doing simple acts, let us say, if you are removing kachara, you know, you are removing, sweeping the floor. If you are sweeping the floor, you have to do the act fully, completely. That means if you have shifted certain things, after removing these, you know, cleaning the floor, put them back where they belong. People will not do that. because they are distracted constantly. Single pointedness is extremely important for human beings. Renounce the sense of doership in all undertaking. Never say, I did this. Never take the doership. The moment you take the doership, you are no longer with Krishna. Do you know where you go? You take the doership, you go to Maya. And Maya is writing down against your name. This is a karma this person has done. 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So you have to be repaid back that thing. But if you are doing it for Krishna, never take the onus of anything. Just keep on doing your activity and never take the doership. Say, I did it. No, don't say that. Only this kind of a devotee is dear to me. We go to the next verse. Chapter 12, verse 17. He who neither rejoices nor hates, nor grieves nor desires, and who renounces both good and evil action, and is full of devotion, is dear to me. Now this is a very critical verse. Listen to it. He who neither rejoices nor hates. I was going through somebody's feed in the Facebook. That person has written how one community has done wrong to another community. And what action is to be taken? Now that is very inflammatory. Why is it important to point fingers? Because what you are doing is the same as what they are doing. And that is the reason why you should never hate another person. And never grieve, never rejoice in anything that is happening in your world. Just because you got victory doesn't mean that you have to rejoice. You should never hate another person. He says, nor grieves nor desires. There should be no grief in your life. So, happens. You know, anything can happen. So don't have that grief. Oh, what am I to do? Imagine if there is grief in the life of Elon Musk. What will he do? One aircraft which is going up, you know, that whatever that rocket that he's sending, it explodes. Oh my God, so much of a problem. You know, when they started that company of theirs, they were literally scraping the bottom. Literally scraping the bottom. They had no money left. And there was only one rocket to be fueled and sent up. They were just crossing their fingers and they said, and Elon Musk and his whole company said, let us see what happens. And the rocket went up and it came down properly. That was the first, you know, the first one which actually landed properly, went up properly and landed properly. Imagine that happening to you. And that was the last they could have ever afforded. Because their company was literally on the verge of closure. So, don't bother about things. Just keep on doing those activities. Here, it's extremely important not to have that grief, you know, what's going to happen? Oh, my rocket got exploded. You know, do the next one, and the next one. And no desires whatsoever. You're just keeping on having a desire is not good. Any kind of desire by itself is not good. One who renounces good and evil. This is now a very difficult thing because people have become very, very, you know, they take sides. They have lost that idea that we are tolerant people. They will ask me this question, how much tolerance can we tolerate? Well, we are supposed to say Atithi Deo Bhav, which means anybody who comes to us and sits on top of our head also is okay. Because there is neither good nor evil in this world. How do you explain this? They ask me. Then I tell them, this is God's doing. Don't you learn in all your scriptures that everything is done by God? Even if a leaf moves, doesn't it move by the will of God, we say? So if there are certain number of people who are doing certain things, it is done by the will of God. Why are you bothered about it? You do what comes to you. Okay? And if you take an aggressive stance and if you think that there is good and there is evil in this world, then Krishna, it's very difficult to achieve Krishna's domain. Please remember that. Then which domain will you achieve? They will say, you see, in the same book, you know, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna tells to Arjuna, go and fight because there are evil people over there. Yes, you are right about it. Arjuna never reached Golok Vrindavan. No. He reached Vaikuntha. So if you want to go to some God's heaven, you are welcome. Do what you think is right. You have good and evil in your world, please go and do what you think is right. If you, there is good and there is evil and you want to fight evil, that is your choice. Those who want to fight evil will go to the heaven of that God which they are praying to, not to Krishna. No way. Krishna's heaven is beyond bounds. You see, out of bounds, you can say. In his world, there is no hate or no likes. There is no good and there is no evil there. Can you overcome that? See, he was only talking about love and devotion, isn't it? Has he spoken anywhere? I will show you, I will break your bones. Has he said any of those things? Even in the Mahabharata war, he was absolutely neutral. He was not on anybody's side. He never took any weapons in hand. He was just strategizing. He was just giving strategies. This is what you got to do. To win a war, you can do this. But he offered himself and his army to both those guys. Arjuna on one side and Duryodhana on the other side. Now whichever one you want, you take. But I am going to be neutral, is what he said. I am not even going to fight for anybody. So he never took sides. He never said anything. People come to me with the word called dharma. What dharma are you talking about? Dharma is misinterpreted by religious people. The word dharma is misinterpreted. Krishna here is saying the one who renounces both good and evil actions and is full of devotion only is dear to me. Now contradict this and show me. It is, cannot be contradicted. He is very clear. So we go to the next verse. We were doing chapter 12, verse 18 and 19 from the Bhagavad Gita. He who deals equally with a friend and foe, here it comes, and is the same in honor and ignominy, who is alike in heat and cold, pleasure and pain and other contrary experiences, and is free from attachment. He who takes praises and reproach alike and is given to contemplation and is contented by any means of subsistence available, entertaining no sense of ownership and attachment in respect of his dwelling place and is full of devotion to me, that person is dear to me. It's a lengthy two verses. The sum total of what Krishna says: he who deals equally with a friend and a foe. Can you do that? The same love that you have for your friend, can you show the love for your foe, your enemy? Now prove me wrong in the Mahabharata. You can't prove me wrong anywhere. Because here are the words which Krishna is saying. This is the only chapter I told you based on devotion. Love and devotion. Another word cannot enter this picture. Love cannot convert into hate. And devotion cannot convert into any other word. No way. If you want to reach Krishna, love and devotion is the only path. And doing your duty without distraction and nishkam karma, a karma which doesn't lead you towards this nor that, that is the only path. Krishna is not advising any other path. Please remember these words. He who deals equally with a friend and a foe. You have to deal in the same way with your enemy, the way you deal with your friend. Can you do that? You cannot cut your enemy into pieces. No. And you cannot take your friend and say, oh, you are my friend. No. If you are treating your friend in one manner, you have to treat your enemy also in the same way. And is the same in ignominy and honor. When somebody honors you and says, you are the greatest thing on planet Earth, don't get carried away by it. Never bother and say, oh, people are coming and honoring me. They are giving me certificates. They are giving me gold medals. I won an Oscar. I won this. I won the national award. 4 national awards, you know. Who gives a damn in for the national awards? You think Krishna cares for your national awards? He doesn't bother about any national awards or international awards also. You should have equanimity of mind when you are getting those awards also. It doesn't matter. Who cares? They're just a piece of paper or some metal. Got it? So in ignominy, when somebody calls you names, you are the worst creature on earth, you are useless, you are this, you are that, people are going to say these words. They will say whatever they feel like in their way, you know, in their mind they will say, useless fellow. Does it matter? Should it matter to you? If it doesn't matter to you, then Krishna is your friend. Then you can go to him. Otherwise, you can't. If you get upset when people say something to you or to anybody else, you know, people get angry and upset. You are saying this to my country. You are saying this to my father. I will show you. Who is this? Whom are you talking about? And if you are doing that, no, you can't reach Krishna. No way. This chapter is meant for those people only. Those who can show love and devotion. Who is alike in heat and cold. Heat on one side and cold on one side. You go through situations in life, you know. Sometimes you are on a fire and sometimes you are literally cold, stone cold. Don't worry. It's okay. Both should be the same. Pleasure and pain. When there is pleasure, don't get so happy about it. And when you get paid, oh my God, look at this. You know, I'm hurting so much. I hear this every day. This is hurting, that is hurting. I am not well, this is not good, that is bad. You think you want sympathy from people? And especially old people, they love to talk nonsense. You know, my legs are hurting. You know, my head is paining. You know, I cut off my finger. You know, my blood pressure has dropped. You know, I am having temperature, fever, this, that. All these kind of things happen. Old people, they should be at least reading these things, no? You should not be bothered about it. Yes, okay, you are sick. So what is the big deal? Take medicines and get okay. Got it? Pleasure and pain and other contrary experiences. And free from attachment. Don't get attached to anybody or anything in the world. If you get attached to anybody in this world, how can you be attached to Krishna then? No. What did Krishna say? Single-pointed devotion. He is not saying you can bring your father also along. You can bring your mother along. He is not saying that. No, no. No way. He is not saying, oh, your wife is also allowed. Your husband is also allowed. He is not saying that. Sorry, boss. They are nobody to you. Did I not tell you? This body of yours is not belonging to you also. It doesn't belong to anybody. Then why are you taking this credit that they are my parents, somebody is my wife, somebody is my husband? Why are you taking this credit? And why are they saying that they belong, you, this body of yours belongs to them? Nobody can belong to anybody. Oh, can I get my wife also? Can I get my husband also? If you get your wife and your husband, that means you are dividing the love. Okay? Single-pointed devotion. Unconditional love. No other love is required. Then only you can go to Krishna. He who takes praises and reproach alike. Some people get upset when they are reproached. Hey, why are you doing like this? They get so angry and upset. Don't bother. Just do your work. Or somebody says, oh, you cooked so nicely. You know, you've done a great meal, blah, blah, blah. And people love to get these praises. Don't bother about praises and reproach also. Is given to contemplation and is contented with any means of subsistence. You should be given to contemplation. Always contemplate on things. And what is the contemplation? Krishna himself has given this to me. Whatever that is there. If that's the state that you are in, it is Krishna's giving. He is giving to you. Why are you bothered? So, contemplate. What is the good thing to be done? What is it that I have to be on the path of sattva and beyond? Think. Thinking is so important. People don't think at all. Alright? Is contented with any means of subsistence. Is anybody contented with any means of subsistence? I doubt it. Then you can't be with Krishna. Whatever is the subsistence, you may get 10 rupees, 5 rupees, 2 rupees, doesn't matter. You should be happy with it. Or even if you get nothing, that also should be okay. All right, no problems at all. Entertaining no sense of ownership and attachment in respect to his dwelling place. It's my house, you know. My place. I own this place. This is my property. Why are you bothered? That's not your property. You are not the owner of this earth. The earth doesn't belong to you. Neither does that patch of land. Neither does that house. Tomorrow I'll kill you. What is going to happen? Who is the owner then? After you are dead, who cares? Do you care? After you are dead, will you be the owner of that property? No. Then why are you bothered so much about property, place, living place? I live over here. This is my house. This is what I do. Don't bother so much about it. You should be able to live wherever possible. If he wants to give you a jhopadpatti, you know, staying in a hut. Stay in a hut. So, what is the big deal? If he gives you one mahal, you know, one palace, live in the palace. And don't become like a mean person, Meghan Markle. Don't. Leaving a palace, talking like that. They will never become. Ingrates they are called. And full of devotion to me. Always be devoted to me. That person is dear to me. When you are devoted to Krishna alone and nobody else. See, I told you. Don't have attachments for anybody else. If you have any other person, just think, my father. Can I bring my father? Can I bring my mother also? No. Can I bring my wife? No. Can you bring your children? No. Can I bring this God with me? When people come to me and they ask me, Guruji, whom should I pray to? I say, pray to whomsoever you feel like. But if you want to be with Krishna, no other person can come in the middle. No other God, no second God, no third God, no fourth God, nothing. Single-pointed devotion. That is the reason why nobody can reach Krishna. Hardly a few. Yeah, you can go to whosoever's heaven that you want to, but you will be sent back to earth again because you will be born and dead and born and dead. Continuous. Your rebirths are continuous. With Krishna, no rebirths at all. Okay, it's one-way ticket only. And when he says, okay, let's go for a show on the earth, he will come. Who wants to join me for the show on the earth? And then, can I come? Can I come? Okay, come. But free ticket back. Got it? And that is why only that person is dear to me. You cannot have attachment of any kind to anybody. Only single-pointed devotion is all that is needed. This is the part of devotion. There is only one verse left. Okay? And we will do this tomorrow. Alright? Because, yes, we have to end this chapter very nicely. So I will stop over here. You take care. Have a great evening. And I'll see you all tomorrow in the evening at the same time. Bye.